Bonjour and Ani, everyone. On behalf of our whole team at Science North, and there are many of us here today, it is both my pleasure and my honor to share a few words to both welcome and acknowledge today's keynote speaker. Several of my amazing colleagues had the opportunity to spend time with her yesterday afternoon, and I thought I'd share some of their verbatim feedback that they shared with me. First, oh my God, she's incredible. I can't even understand how one human can hold so much knowledge. And we are so lucky to have spent time with her. And indeed, we are all lucky to be spending some time with her here this morning. Now, as I look out into the crowd, I do see several familiar faces, but if we haven't had the chance to meet yet, as Marianne said, my day job is as the CEO of Science North in Sudbury, Ontario, Canada, which also means my night job is as the CEO of Science North in Sudbury, Ontario, Canada. In preparing this year's remarks, I reflected on the conference theme, and it didn't take long to make the connection that we really are communities of change. So think about it as an example. As new scientific discoveries are made, we change our approach. We update our content, we adjust our programming, and we consult with experts who can help us to guide a new approach. As we now collectively deepen our knowledge and confront our past while acknowledging the severe impacts of colonization, I know we're all reflecting on how we might change our approach. Well, we need to update our content, adjust our programming, and consult with experts who can help to guide us. Indigenous ways of knowing and how they braid together with a Western science perspective is at the heart of how we can and must change our path forward. At Science North, we recognize the strength of an approach that brings together mainstream science with place-based, intergenerational, lived knowledge of our local Indigenous communities. Stronger together, these strands of knowledge will meet, inform, and guide each other, and incorporate multiple viewpoints to create a broader and more meaningful perspective for our visitors. Our goal is to weave together cultural knowledge with traditional science to create a better informed, more sustainable model of living, always considering how we will create a positive impact for the seven generations who will follow us. Sustainability, stewardship, regeneration, and an interconnected relationship with the world around us are at the heart of Indigenous knowledge that will infuse and inspire our path forward. When we learned who this year's keynote speaker was, we were absolutely thrilled to come on as the keynote partner. Today, we are joined by Melanie Goodchild, Moose Clan, Anishinaabe Ojibwe woman from Bitigong Anishinaabe First Nation, and Ketagonzibi, or Garden River First Nation. Melanie is a systems thinking and complexity scholar who offers a uniquely Anishinaabe approach to making sense of society's most entrenched challenges. She will soon defend her PhD in social and ecological sustainability in the School of the Environment, Resources and Sustainability in the Faculty of the Environment at the University of Waterloo. Melanie is a research fellow with the Waterloo Institute for Social Innovation and Resilience and a faculty member of the U School for Transformation by the Presencing Institute, the Academy for Systems Change, and the Wolf Willow Institute for Systems Learning. She is an International Women's Forum Leadership Fellows Program alumni, a program that's sponsored by Harvard Business School and INSEAD. Next month, Melanie will be taking on a new role for as the first ever academic director, Makwa Wakayigan at Algoma University. Melanie lives with her family in Bawating, a place of the rapids, in the traditional territory of the Three Fires Confederacy. And she joins us today to tell the story of decolonizing or unbraiding at the interface of Anishinaabe wisdom and neuroscience. Chimigwech to Melanie for sharing this knowledge with us. And now, please join me in welcoming to the stage Melanie Goodchild.
Kwe, Minogijap, Minogijigad. Bojo and Denim Omaganaduk, that's greetings to you, all of my relatives. Apajigo, Miguich Bizin Dawiyug, Wabshkeo Gitadakwez, Anang Indigenikas, Waban Angakwe Indigenikas, Moos and Dodem, Biktagong Nishnabeg and Donjaba, Kitagon Zibi and Donjaba, Errol Land, Nindonchi, and Kuchiching Nindonchi. So I said, greetings to you, all of my relatives. Thank you for listening. So I'm also known in English as Melanie, named after my dad, Delaney, my late father, Delaney, Delaney Va, and my mother, Melinda, and they halved it up and spelled it like Melanie. But it's pronounced Melanie. My mom keeps saying, don't tell people we spelled it wrong. So they didn't spell it wrong. They just spelled it differently. And I said my two spirit names in my clan, Moose, Moose and Dodem. So you will see Moose on my ribbon skirt and on my moccasins. And so this helps ground me, but these are also helpers of mine. And I'm going to talk a little bit about helpers today. And when I come to a territory like this, and thank you to Elder Fred for welcoming us here and telling us about, you know, the spirits that are here, the ancestors that are here. When I travel to a different territory, I usually ground myself. And yesterday I had the opportunity to do that. So I'd like to thank CASC for finding us that beautiful space there. There was a lodge that we were in, and I met with some of the indigenous folks that are part of the CASC family, the CASC community. And we had an opportunity just to sit together, sit in circle. And I was able to introduce myself in a good way, because what I'm going to talk about today is about relationships. And relationships are really the key of what we would call systemic transformations. And in the field that I'm in, it's really about enabling the conditions for those transformations to happen. And so what do we do to enable those conditions? So it's a little bit different way of speaking. And I've heard sometimes that folks go, I've never heard anyone speak like that. So you might be in for some new stuff. I talk a little bit in metaphor. Sometimes it's quite literal, but sometimes it's also metaphoric. And so I'm going to introduce myself a little bit further in the language and introduce the two helpers that I have with me, which is a Migaze Miguan, an eagle feather, and a Mikinak Shishiguan, the turtle rattle. These are gifts that were given to me for my medicine bundle. These are part of my personal medicine bundle, but also part of the work that I do. Because I shared this yesterday, and I wish I could take credit for it, but I'm kind of a settler whisperer. And so that's my friend Tyson Young Comporta. He is a settler whisperer. So I do a lot of cross-cultural work. I work with people from all kinds of different nations all over the world. And in doing that, I focus actually on healing self and healing systems. And don't always call it that, because some folks don't want to sign up for a workshop called Healing Self and Systems, because healing is a journey. It's about vulnerability. It's about humility. It's about recognizing sometimes that we're not quite over what we thought we were over, something that happened in our childhood, or the disconnect that we as humanity have from Mother Earth and how much we're really grieving that. And so in the circle yesterday, I asked people to introduce themselves by telling me about their Minigowiziwin. So Minigowiziwin is something taught to me by my sister Eleanor. Minigo, that which is given to you, is your win from somebody else, but that somebody else is kind of assumed to be Gizhe Manito, the great spirit, the creator, or your ancestors, the universe. It can also be other human beings. And so a friend of mine, Leroy Little Bear, who's a Blackfoot knowledge keeper, he was sharing this story recently. We were at the ROM, and there was a panel on star knowledge, which I know some of you are quite familiar with. And he was talking about a teaching. And there was a monk who was having a glass of water, and the assistant was pouring the glass of water and said, you know, stop, like, let me know, say when. And so the assistant was pouring this glass of water, and the monk just watched it, and it kept overflowing, right? It was all over the table. And the assistant said, you're supposed to say when. Well, Leroy took that and said, well, that teaching is about in a mainstream or a dominant way of thinking, the ways of knowing, the multiple ways of knowing, but the ways that have dominated most of our ways of thinking, especially through university and formal education, knowledge is seen as filling up your glass. And then it's so full, we don't even stop when it's overflowing, right? We don't take a breath. Whereas in indigenous wisdom, when we think about wisdom, Anishinaabe, Gik, and Dasawin, our original ways of knowing, and Damawin, our wisdom, it's actually about emptying that glass. So it's a really different goal. And so what helps us do that are ceremonies. So ceremonies help us empty that glass so that we can add some more in there. But you're also letting go of things, and it's okay to let go. You know, there's sort of like when systems thinking, we call it a rigidity trap, when we refuse to let something go, right? There's a feedback loop there, and it's blocked through rigidity. When we experience that in ourselves at an individual level, often it's because, you know, what are we going to let go of? There's some fear there. And in healing processes, we acknowledge and we're ready to let go. So that's the invitation today, is to maybe let go. And what I do is seek consent, because I might be speaking about customs and traditions and languages that you're not familiar with, particularly to the translators. Sometimes I'll be speaking in Anishinaabe, and I'll try to translate those words. I said, I acknowledge the four directions, and I said, thank you to Mother Earth for giving us the water that we're drinking, the water that's in our coffee and tea, nibishabo, our tea, the food that we're going to eat or that we ate this morning. And in acknowledging the four directions, I also acknowledge the eighth fire prophecy. So the prophecy that the Ashkabadizig, the new people, would come together. And we would reach a crossroads where we would either choose the destruction of all life on Earth Mother or with Earth Mother, or we would choose a different path. The Hopi prophecy is about the two-hearted and the one-hearted. The two-hearted people are torn, right? They're torn between things like capitalism and modernity. The one-hearted people come together in a holistic way. And so that's kind of what I study. I study holistic thinking. Within the field of science, that was recognized as a response to reductionist thinking and to mechanistic thinking. And there was something called general science and general systems theory, sorry. And so that's a little bit of what I studied. And then I also studied sustainability science. So I'm going to try to stick to time and go through the slides. These will be available for you. So this is just part of my storytelling, that the slides are available for you. So you don't have to write notes. Sometimes I see people writing notes and I think that's a lot to write down. This is my other helper. This is a Migazay Miguan. This is an eagle feather. And so I've been going to ceremonies since I was about 12 years old. And like many people, Anishinaabe people, I was on a journey to reclaim, revitalize language, to revitalize ceremony, because my dad went to residential school. My mom went to Indian day school in Garden River. My dad went to Spanish Indian residential school. And so I learned some of the language, but I don't speak fluently, and I was not learning about our ceremonies. And so my dad passed when I was just short of 10 years old from leukemia, and my mom moved us back to Thunder Bay. And that's where I discovered elders. I discovered elders that were living in the cities with us, and they would tell me about the ceremonies. And so I sought those out, and I was a young woman that wanted to dance in the powwow. So I became a fancy shawl dancer, and I went on the powwow trail and followed what we call the Red Road. And in that, I was starting to discover these kind of distinct worldviews. And so I became a youth activist, and I was an anti-racism activist. When I was like 14 or 15, I won the Ontario Native Women's Association Youth Award. And then I spoke at the Kuchiching Institute for Public Affairs when I was 18. Someone asked me if I wanted to be prime minister. And I said, no, I don't. And it had a mixed reaction. And I said, I don't think that's my way. And that really reflected those two worlds. And that's a little bit of what I continue to study, these different worlds. But these worlds have come together. And sometimes when they come together, it's a clash. And other times when these worlds come together, it's a gift. And if we think of it as a gift, it's a whole different way of experiencing the sharing of multiple ways of knowing. So this eagle feather has the four colors. This was my late cousin's feather. It was in her bundle when she passed, and I'm looking after that. She was a pipe carrier, a Pawagon. I had the gift of getting a Pawagon to live with me, to look after when I was 19 years old. So, and I'm 52 now. So I'm heading into a different phase of my life, elderhood, trying to get used to that idea. Been a pipe carrier since I was 19, which means I'm just learning. And so I'm constantly emptying my cup. Nigani Mini Go Iziwin. I called the talk today Nigani Mini Go Iziwin because I go to the language speakers and to the knowledge keepers and the elders. I go on the land and I go in ceremony and I take science with me, and then I ask them to reinterpret it for me. What would that mean from our perspective? That's still a decolonizing process. I mean, a fully decolonized process would be, I wouldn't even have complexity and science with me. I would just be listening to the stories. But I'm in the space in between, the nexus or the interface between different worldviews. And the elders actually that I get to be in relationship with love talking about science and complexity. They really love the challenge of, this is how our ancestors viewed the world. And so Nagaanim and Ngozi-win is how the elders interpreted systemic transformation. I told them if we were changing the resource and flows and the feedback loops of systems because of their undesirable outcomes, what would we call that? And they said, it's called the gifts we give to the future. Because the spirits and the ancestors here are distress. Most people who are pursuing transformative change projects or processes are doing so because of undesirable outcomes of the systems that we've created as human beings, right? So inequity, justice, oppression. We see them, we see the measurables of that, and we want to figure out how to change it. But these are not simple or complicated problems. They're very complex. And so we need a complexity mindset to do that. And so this is a little bit about having a complexity mindset. This happened as a story. And so I'm going to share it as a story, walking in the woods with complexity and the unframework, because I was trying to create a framework. This is no longer a framework, and letting go. So it's my story of letting go of wanting to develop a complexity modeling framework. And you'll see what I mean by that. So Wasanabada means we look in all directions. When we start problem solving and creating the conditions for the spirits to help us with this problem solving, this is what Sandra Indian and Onigaming taught me. I knew that the idea of Wasanabada, and I thought it meant the four directions. She said, no, I can see how your mind might go to that. But it means the seven generations to come, the seven generations before us, and our generation now. And you're holding that simultaneously. Right. So linear thinkers, we don't know how to reconcile that we're holding all of that time together, but we are. And so that's what Wasanabada is. So the main question that guides thinking about doing a collective wisdom journey together, which is, I think, what CASC is on, particularly with Indigenous peoples involved in the network, is how do we make meaning together? How do we co-sense, co-learn, and co-create together in different ways? And what does that look like? This is a fairly long quote, but I think it's a brilliant quote by my colleague, Rick Hill, who's Tuscarora. He's an artist, writer, and curator. So I'm going to share this full quote with you. What does it take to empower the next generation of thinkers? For Haudenosaunee, here every year, they have a recitation of the prophecy. And I think he's talking about the prophecy of the Code of Handsome Lake in Mohawk, the message we received in 1799. So people are fairly knowledgeable about that. The last 7 years, we've been doing a recitation of the Great Law in all our communities, and we're getting better on that. But what we haven't done is regular recitation of our creation story. That is the roadmap to this interconnected web. This is the ultimate system that we exist by. And I think in the end, if you compare Anishinaabe creation and Haudenosaunee creation in this region, there's a commonality about why the world was created and how and why we humans were created to inhabit the land. That's the knowledge we need to uncover. I was working on this project called the Cosmogram of our universe through Haudenosaunee eyes to revisualize, because you have to have that. And when you start looking at that, the language, it explains things a little differently. I think that's important when you can revisualize creation as a whole entity, a functioning entity beyond the sky world, and to below the turtle. When you revision it in three dimensions and Dolby stereo, you will then innately understand your relationship and your place in that universe. And you won't need a textbook or somebody to explain to you what you need to be doing. You will embrace it. That's what I meant by having faith in the unseen. It's worked for 10,000 years. It's begging us now to re-engage with it. But we get so distracted trying to change things, change education here and there. I think we've stifled the ability of our kids to feel that vibrational energy message from the earth. And so this is a poem about powerful strangers. And, you know, you can read it along, you can close your eyes and listen, but this will help us get ready for the next part of the story. Stand still. The trees ahead and bushes beside you are not lost. Wherever you are is called here, and you must treat it as a powerful stranger. Must ask permission to know it and be known. The forest breathes. Listen, it answers. I have made this place around you. If you leave it, you may come back again saying here. No two trees are the same to raven. No two branches are the same to wren. If what a tree or branch does is lost on you, then you are surely lost. Stand still. The forest knows where you are. You must let it find you. And that's a quote by a non-Indigenous poet, but it reminds me of what my friend and brother, Teokasin Ghost Horse, who's Lakota, says. People are always talking about saving Mother Earth. What we need to do is get out of the way so she can save us. So I talked about relationships, and a lot of the work that I do with different organizations, collectives, and institutions around the world that are tackling wicked problems is giving us the opportunity to meet powerful strangers. And in that, in our way, we talk about helpers, we talk about spirit beings, the Manadug. So here's three outcomes, and particularly for those that I work with a lot of philanthropists and communities of practice of philanthropic organizations that are funding work like you do. And there's always questions of measurement, right? And return on investment. How do we measure the success? Like, how do we measure something like decolonization? So one, we need to stop trying to design the solution and instead design for the conditions that enable the emergence of many solutions. And I think that's a really beautiful approach for institutions that are looking to work with Indigenous peoples and across multiple ways of knowing, is what are the conditions that we need? And that could be physical, spiritual, mental, and emotional. Fostering more quality and trusted relationships is a critical enabler of that emergence. So what if you measured the outcome of the work as how many, not really even how many relationships were created, but focused on the nature of those relationships and how deep those relationships are. For the catalyzers of complex system change, often government, that means starting to value relationships is a key outcome. Early in my career, I did some work with NASA in the United States, and they were doing GIS and geospatial technology and introducing that to Indigenous communities. And Indigenous communities had already engaged with that. So Dr. Carletta Chief, who's in the Navajo Nation, uses real-time satellite data to monitor the drought in the Navajo Nation. The Sami reindeer herders look, because of climate change, the snow is changing, and the reindeer can't punch through that tough layer of snow. And so they were already using the technology, but they wanted to build relationships. And the first thing that the team said to me was, you know, let's have a meeting in Washington, right? So let's have a meeting in Ottawa. And I said, well, how about not? What if you come to us, because we're always coming to you? So in that bridging that we talk about physically, often we're the ones as Indigenous peoples that are coming to a different space that's not our home, into buildings like this where, you know, can we smudge or not and things like that. And so I said, reach out to your network. And they did. And they reached out, and we ended up meeting in Red Lake Reservation in Wisconsin. And so I had scientists there from Goddard Research Center, from the Ames Research Center, from headquarters. And it was the first time NASA ever met on a reservation. And we did systems mapping together. And it was a way to introduce the fact that the Native American communities and that the scientists working in all these different spaces were sort of part of the same ecosystem. So there's the metaphor of the ecosystem, but then there's also the ecosystem, right? Like our Earth Mother, that they're all a part of. So these are some of the principles that I talk about. Gadina Windaman means that we are all related. Bindigo Dadawin, to enter one another's lodge. So when we're doing decolonizing work, that's what we're doing. We're entering one another's lodge, our wigwams. And so there's an ethics to that, right? An ethic of respect and a recognition of the power dynamics, being a good host, hospitality, radical hospitality. Now we aki is middle ground, so aki is land. Now we aki is the middle ground, so it's that space between entering one another's lodge. This is important because when I started to study science from an Anishinaabe perspective, I was entering someone else's lodge. That's not my way of looking at the world, my way of making sense of reality. And so this middle ground, this when we bring in Anishinaabe, Yik, and Dasawun, our original ways of knowing, this middle ground is like Albert Marshall's two-eyed seeing. It's like Willie Ermine's ethical space. But I started to work on something called relational systems thinking. And so here, I won't read the whole quote because I want to stay on time. But this is John Mohawk, the late John Mohawk, who was a Seneca scholar. And he said that there's agreement that we need poetry as much as we need telescopes. And in his mind, in the two-row consciousness of the Haudenosaunee people, those two can live simultaneously together. They can live in harmony. And so we need poetry and telescopes, right? So we need dreams and visions, and we also need clarity of what's happening around us. And there wasn't this binary thinking. And so transcending binary thinking and transcending hierarchical thinking are important aspects of relational systems thinking. So when I was given this definition of resilience, some of you may be familiar with this, Walker and Salt and C.S. Hollings, the capacity of a complex adaptive system or a social ecological system to absorb a shock or a disturbance, to reorganize and essentially retain its identity. So when we almost lost Lake Erie, if it had reached a tipping point, it would have flipped into something unrecognizable, right? It wouldn't be a lake anymore. It would be a desert. There would just be sand left. So when we collectively as humanity kind of didn't let Lake Erie die, that is the definition of resilience. So I reached out to some language speakers, and because I was reading this in my studies, and I was saying, I don't think I've ever heard an elder say it like that. I've never heard an elder say nature or environment or ecology or biosphere or Anthropocene. They say Giddakimanan. Giddakimanan means everything in creation. So I said, so how would you say resilience? So my cousin, Rene Meshanki, he said, Sibiskagan, Sibi river, Biska, flexible, God it is. You might say that resilience is a river flowing flexibly through the land. And my sister, Eleanor Skeet, said, Mama Sinjige, the act of twists and turns and moves. Mama Sinjawan is the water flow in twisting and turning. There always has to be context with Ojibwe words. Linguists call these hollow phrases, hollow phrases. I can do an exercise with you that would take you through a hollow phrastic reading of our colonized minds and a hollow phrastic reading of the brilliance of the complexity thinking of Anishinaabe ancestors. That's sort of like how I do systems change work. And so this word, which I can't even pronounce very well, I think Fred could probably do better than me, but Jimisawa Bandaming. Positive window shopping for your future. And so that's a process of, say, a social innovation lab. And when I said that to Eleanor, she said, well, I think about that when I was a little girl and I would look at the pastries in the bake shop. But it wasn't just looking at it and wanting it. I also had the intention to go in and buy it. And so it's actually showing him or her so that he or she can wish for something. So Jamis is to desire for, and that's what systems transformation work is. And so going through a process of what do we desire for CASC and what do we desire for science centers and for children, right? For the next seven generations. I was living in Haudenosaunee territory when I was doing my PhD. And so I was taught by my Uncle Dan Longboat and my Uncle Blaine Loft. Uncle Dan is from Six Nations. Uncle Blaine is from Tiendanega. They're spiritually adopted uncles of mine. So this is a cultural fluency for me because I'm not Mohawk. And they taught me about this, the two-row wampum belt, the original treaty between the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, then known as the Iroquois Confederacy, and the Dutch and later the French and the British. These three rows, the white rows in the back, those are all sacred wampum shells. You know, we do a ceremony for every shell that's taken and formed into these tubes and strung on these wampum belts. And so those three in the background are the river of life, and we share the river of life together. That was the understanding. The two columns in the middle, the purple, are the Dutch sailing ship and the Iroquois birch bark canoe. It was a recognition and a treaty of peace, friendship, respect, but also equal but differentiated. And it wasn't about hybridity and mixing. It was actually a recognition of sovereign nations and that they were equal. And so the colonial relationship that took over was not what was represented in this initial treaty. But it's also, according to my Uncle Dan, in this time, in Ojibwe, we say the eighth fire, the Ashkamadazig, in his words, he says, it's all hands on deck. The river of life is now herself in jeopardy. So I wrote a paper with the Haudenosaunee intelligentsia, four elders that I got to sit with, and some systems thinkers, Peter Senge and Otto Scharmer from MIT. And I work with the Presidency Institute. So we do systems change projects, looking at connecting to source and understanding the emerging future. So the first paper, relational systems thinking, that's how change is going to come from our Earth Mother. I wrote in a two-row visual code, and I'll show you that in a moment. And then the second paper was the Dabajimawin, the story of how I was kind of re-theorizing systems thinking and complexity. But I just wanted to show you quickly this, the two-row visual code. Very, very limiting, as you know, to write in a language that isn't yours, to write in a form that isn't yours. So an academic journal, this is a double-blind peer-reviewed journal at MIT. They're not ready for, you know, poetry. They're not ready for what John Mohawk said. We still have these academic markers that they're looking for. So what I did, it's not just a rhetorical device, but it's actually an invitation as well to read the two columns. So on one side is some of Peter Senge's story, and the other side is Kevin Deer, who's a faith keeper in the Mohawk Trail Longhouse from Ganawagi. It's to sort of see that as I was talking to them all, they were telling me the same stories, and it was all about connecting to Earth Mother. So it had, I think, 23,000 views in the first few months that it was out. So it's been well received, and I kind of do guest lectures and presentations like this about it. But what it was an invitation to think about that space between the sacred space as a place of co-creation, as a place of emergence, where I talk about dancing with the flow of emergence, or the mushkiki, the medicine of emergence, can flow. So on one side, you might have systems thinking. On the other side, Anishinaabe Minobamatsuzuin, our good life, our way of life. And in the middle are the teachings of what I was calling relational systems thinking. So that was a model I developed. And this is seen, this is the University of Calgary. They talk about walking parallel paths. So lots of institutions have different ways of talking about their work in reconciliation and decolonization. The important part here is that it's the space between, it's the third space, which comes out of cultural theory. It's also the interface, and it cultivates a complexity pattern of thinking. And so systems thinking is a lot about pattern recognition, and it's about reframing patterns and understanding what those patterns are telling of us about the deeper layers of the system. When these knowledge systems come together, it's often a cultural clash. And so when we think about equity, diversity, if it's not specifically anti-oppressive and anti-racist, what we have are Black and brown bodies that come into the room, that come into the, you know, into the classroom, or come onto the board of directors. And then you might have one Indigenous person speak for what they believe in, but they're vilified for doing that because their epistemologies and cosmologies show up with their bodies. Right? And so Keokanen talks about that, this cultural clash, and that really we need to embrace the logic of the gift. This is a scholar, and a scholar, but he probably wouldn't call himself that. Arkin Lashwala, Deer and Thunder, Indigenous Ways of Restoring the World. He talks about how in his language, there is no masculine feminine. And so because in English, particularly, we have this binary all the time, these binary ways of thinking, and we're kind of socialized. And so then we have polarities, and we have opposites, and we have polarization. But what he says is he can practice a way of reasoning that doesn't take side, but in dances with two opposites. They'll dance together until a third presence shows up. And so I think that's one of the entry points to actually really engaging in true, not token decolonization, but authentic decolonization or indigenization, multiple ways of knowing, is to dance. And you can still hold those polarities. And so it's not about an utter rejection of either, right? So it's not about this way is wrong and this way is right. It's more about what happens when they come together and they're in an ethical conversation together. And so I'm joining CASC for 4 months as a systems changer in residence, which I think is, I want to acknowledge Marianne for that and Stephanie, because this is what I recently completed, a 4-month systems changer in residence, which is like, you know, when artists are in residence somewhere. But I'm your systems artist in residence for 4 months, and I'll be working specifically on looking at complexity in CASC and its mission. And so one of my friends is Tyson Young Comporta from Australia, and he wrote this beautiful book called Santok. how Indigenous thinking can save the world. And he wrote about systems and complexity thinking from his Aboriginal perspective. So he wrote the book, you know, I wish I could have wrote. And we had a residency, or I had a residency for 4 months last fall. And my residency included two writing retreats and also working with the Greater Good Studio, a human-centered design studio in Chicago, to bring some of my work forward into the world. And you'll see the results of that. But during one of the writing retreats, Tyson and his family joined me and my family in Niagara Falls. We spent a week together and I wrote about the residency writing retreat. And it's on our Wolf Willow website. It's called Duck Shit Tea, Yarning in the Magical Space in Between Things. And it's actually about our different cultures coming together. And we all love tea, particularly the practice of Gong Fu Cha, which is from our relatives in the East, Chinese tea service. And so we had this particular, which is a really good tea, duck shit tea. And then yarning is a cultural practice of sharing knowledge, a little bit different than our talking circles and sharing circles where we pass around an eagle feather and, you know, everybody listens and we go around a number of times. In yarning, it's about generative conversation. You're often doing something. So I've introduced yarning to our elders and knowledge keepers, and I'll yarn with, you know, with elders from across Turtle Island. It's also about drinking tea and eating, because the teaching is when we have conversations like this, if you're not drinking or eating, you're not really metabolizing the energy of the information that I'm sharing with you. So all these vibrations that I'm sending out to you, human beings need help to make that a reality. And so the elders will often say, drink something and eat something, please. So this is what I was trying to do when I started working with the Greater Good Studio, as I mentioned, a human-centered design firm in Chicago. I wanted to create a framework. Actually, I wanted to create a complexity modeling framework so that I could help people, you know, do systems change work from an Anishinaabe perspective. And this looked really kind of familiar to me. So you'll see, some of you will recognize on the outside, the seven grandfather or grandmother teachings, you know, like truth and love, wisdom. In the middle is our sacred teaching, the medicine circle teaching, the medicine wheel, which is also on this, you know, is quite familiar to a lot of our nations, and there are specific teachings that go with that. And then along the outside are 14 principles, I was calling them. And in the middle are teachings about complexity, being probabilistic, integrative, inclusive, and adaptive. And then we hired an artist. So this is me with the Greater Good Studio team in Chicago. And they started to ask me about, you know, 500 questions. It's kind of daunting. It's humbling when four designers want to bring your vision to life. So you answer a lot of questions, but you're also a little bit freaked out, like, wow, this is a lot of money and time on little old me trying to just say something. And so these are some of the designs I liked. So they created these compositions, ideas for a complexity modeling framework, and the principles, I was still calling them 14, but we got down to 7. I was quite here attached emotionally to the medicine wheel. Then we hired Ocean Kiena, who's a brilliant artist, fashion designer, beadwork artist. She's only 23 years old. She made the ribbon skirt. I'll show you in a moment. And she came back with these drawings. She says, I hear you talking, Melanie, about relationships, dreams, and the beings that you meet. And I looked at these three compositions and I thought, but where's the medicine wheel? You know, where's my principles? I need this to be recognized as a framework. And so in my colonized mind, I was still really holding on to something that I thought I could cite because other people have written about, you know, the medicine wheel, something that was a little bit more like pan-Indigenous in a way. I gave into that pressure. And something that made sense sort of logically that would bring in complexity science, which I thought had to be in English. This is Bert and Eleanor Skeed, elders in Wajishkunagum, and I yarned with them 6 times. And I had a budget so that I paid them well, and we yarned on Zoom. And I've been in ceremony with them. They're my adopted family, and then that's my husband there. And so we had these yarns together. And they came back and they said, well, this isn't a framework, this is a story. There's three types of stories: Adzukan, traditional legends; Dabajamowin, a traditional story; and a Gakikwewinan, a life teaching. So this is your Gakikwewinan, Melanie. This is your whole life here in this dissertation, in this framework. And they said, and these principles are the beings you met on your journey. And where did you meet these beings? Well, I met them in ceremony in the woods with the Stick Nation behind my brother's sweat lodge and our fasting grounds in Garden River, where we have our ceremonies. I was walking in the woods with complexity, and I met grandfather Birch and grandmother Cedar. And I learned that grandmother Cedar likes to plant her feet in the water. So if you're ever lost in the bush and you look for grandmother Cedar, you will have water. Grandfather Birch doesn't get struck by lightning, the Animiki. That's why we built our lodges out of birch bark. I keep looking at knowledge keepers over there and they're nodding something. Looking at Fred, what's he doing? And so when you're in the bush and you're lost, our young people were told many years ago, look for your relatives, look for your grandmother, look for your grandfather, because they will look after you and they will help you get home. You're not alone when you're all by yourself in the deep woods and you hear the bear over there, Makwa, uh-oh, I've gone hungry, right? And if he's hungry, she's looking for berries anyway, not really looking for you. But that's the colonized mind, right? The colonized mind means that we, as Anishinaabe people who have survived so much attacks on our culture and our way of life, think differently. We start to think like the settlers, which Teokasin calls baby turtle islanders. And so because settlers have only been here a very short time in the long period of the 60,000 some years that our peoples have been here, we've been here on this land in relationship with this land for centuries and centuries and centuries. And I work a lot in the US, and you'll often hear, I'm a fifth, sixth generation farmer, you know, in Kentucky. And I know that's part of a lineage, but there's a longer lineage for them. You know, where did they come from? Because they have ancestors and they had spirit helpers too, until the rational mind said, no, that's nonsense, right? And then the rational mind came here and looked at us and thought we were worshiping things, and we weren't. We were in relationship with our kinship, with our family. So I looked at these and I thought, okay. So she started to create some other drawings. There's another one. And she started to add, that's Labrador tea, which grows a lot in Biktagong, Anishinaabeg. Labrador tea is a lovely medicine, a mushkiki, a bishabo tea. She started to fill in and she said, oh, there's Melanie walking. And she put a ribbon skirt on me and said, I was walking with my rattle. And here's the most critical insight I think that I'd love to share with you. Anishinaabe, Gikindosu, and our original ways of knowing cannot be standardized. And that's the whole basis of the dominant education system: standardize. You learn this definition of this word. You learn these facts, and then you repeat them. You say, okay, I passed the test. But as soon as we try to standardize our knowledge, which is what traditional ecological knowledge tends to do, TEK, compartmentalize, put it here, and then it really looks at Anishinaabe Gikindosuwin from an ecological standpoint or a science standpoint. Instead, the invitation is to think about, what if we didn't standardize? That means it's local, it's historical, it's not ahistorical, it's in this time and place, it's those wasa, nabada, you look in all directions. It's based on the language of this place, and it's being in relationship with the people who have that knowledge. And that takes time, takes money, just different set of measurables. And so in systems thinking, if there's any systems geeks out there, we have something called archetypes, right? So patterns that we see in systems and feedback loops. One of the archetypes is shifting the burden. So shifting the burden is an archetype where it looks like a number 8. So in the middle is an event level crisis or an event. And then we seek symptomatic solutions, whereas underneath are actually the fundamental solutions. Once we seek those symptomatic solutions, the side effect is it kind of makes it look like we solved the problem, but we haven't, because we've just addressed something at a more shallow level. And so the example is homelessness, right? So we've got someone who's unhoused and experiencing homelessness. We know some fundamental solutions like basic income and really dealing with what puts someone at risk, right? Intergenerational trauma. Those are a little bit too complex for any one organization or person to solve. So instead, we look at something else like homeless shelters. While homeless shelters are an important aspect of harm reduction on the continuum, they're not the answer. What they do is they have homeless people out of our view as society. And then we think we've solved the problem, but we haven't, because we haven't addressed what is leading to the addictions crisis. And so I'm working with Treaty 3 on the opioid crisis, and I'm working with the Center for Care Innovations. I just got back from Los Angeles, where we're working on JEDI, they call it, justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion, and getting medically assisted treatment to people in California who are Native American, Black, and Latinx people. And the most vulnerable of our society is who we've tended to abandon the most often. And when we standardize knowledge, we just check off boxes, you know, and that's what kind of gets us in trouble, Eleanor said. And so Nagani Minagoja, when I published it, that's the final drawing on my website. And the elders suggested I just put it on my own website instead of making it a part of like a project or a program, because it's actually my story. And I don't want to standardize it. When you read it, it's Melanie's story. It's not your story, but you can learn from the story. And so we give these gifts to the future. You know, we created this illustration. I say we went back and forth. And then we added these seven beings. And I'm going to kind of wrap up by sharing who these seven beings are for me. So when I was walking in the woods with complexity, I met Mushkiki One. I just told you about them. Medicines. The medicines are all of the plants. They're the stories. They're our relatives, the sun, the moon, the stars. And who are the beings you meet along the way? Bawajiganan. These are your dreams. Nibishabo, tea. Manitou Kewanun, ceremonies. Nawiaki, middle ground. Ishgode, which is fire. And Oshkabewasug, the helpers. These are the seven beings who came to me and helped me when I was trying to understand complexity from a decolonized mindset. I could understand it quite straightforward from a colonized mind. I just read the textbooks and I knew how to understand the material. But what I needed to do was let go of something. So I let go of the medicine wheel because Eleanor said, "What's your relationship with the medicine wheel?" I said, "I don't know. I mean, I've heard that for a long time. I've talked about it. I know other nations have that. I can cite it." That's why I kept thinking, I don't know, I can cite it. People have written about it. And I did have teachings of that myself from my stepfather, who's a medicine man from Big Grassy First Nation, Alvin Copenes. He told me about those four colors a long time ago. She said, "What are your colors?" Well, these are my colors. I have seven colors. I dreamt about them when I was on the powwow trail. I was in Anishinaabe First Nation, and I dreamt about these seven ribbons flowing in the wind, just seven long ribbons. And I was dancing, and I was in Whitefish Bay in my dream, a community up there in Treaty 3. And my dad said, my stepfather said, these are your colors. So we have clans, we have colors, and we have names, right? That's just some of our helpers. And so she said, Eleanor said, "Put your colors on there." And so that's what Ocean drew. And then Ocean, being a fashion designer, said, "I'll make the skirt for you." I said, "Okay, so I have another helper." And that would be my PhD dissertation. I'll go back to that. That's it right there. That picture not translated, that's decolonized Anishinaabe Yikandasawin. That's our wisdom and knowledge. It's a story, it's place-based, kind of have to have a cup of tea with me to go through it. It's emotional. It kind of makes people, I think, emotional. It makes me emotional. I when I really want to, you know, do the ugly cry is when I think about biodiversity loss and I think about our relatives. Chief Dan George talked about a wolf ceremony. Remember a long time ago in those two little books he put out? He put out this book, My Heart Soars and My Spirit Soars. And I read them when I was like 12 and 13 years old. And he said, in one of them, he takes his grandson out into the bush and he sings the wolf song on the drum and the wolves don't answer him. And the grandson says, "Grandpa, can I go watch TV now?" And he said, "What if we you know, forget the songs? What if we don't sing the songs? But what if we go in the bush and we sing the songs and the wolves don't answer us? And why wouldn't they answer us? Maybe they're gone. Maybe we abandoned them so long, our kinship with them, that they don't even hear our song anymore. And to me, those two ideas are heartbreaking. And that's why Eleanor said, they hear your distress, Melanie, when you shake that rattle. That rattle's for healing. She said, they hear your distress. And when the spirits start doing their work, that's when systems transformation happens. I thought, wow, beautiful. That's yarning with knowledge keepers. If you sat with Fred here and yarned for an hour and, you know, you sat with some of your Indigenous colleagues and we bring in this relationship we have with elders and knowledge speakers, and that's what they teach you. I always say it's like a mic drop, you know. I'll just like let loose, you know, Teokas and Ghost Horse on someone and just say, let's have a yarn, and we'll have 20 people on Zoom, and he'll just, you know, drop the mic like 20 times. The final story is on my website. I'm not sharing it with you here. You can take a look at it and you can hear me reading it. There's a full story. It's like a little flip book, because it's really about you being in relationship with this story. But it's also not in my doctoral dissertation. Because it's a Gakikwewanun, it's alive. It's cognizant of the fact it's being shared today. So it's going to play with me. It's going to play with you. And because it's alive and it's a spirit, it's respected. And I didn't want to capture it in time on a piece of paper. So there's other aspects of my dissertation that are on there. So complex systems cannot be explained by their parts, right? And so relationships are key. And these connections define how complex systems work. And to wrap up, I'm supposed to be done at 11, right? Okay. I always have to bring in time into everything. And I always talk about we shift time and we don't pay attention to time, but here I am. So systems transformation is about the gifts we give to the future and shifting how we are in relationship with each other. But there's an anthropocentric bias to conventional systems thinking. It's really about for us as human beings, right? We're saving the planet for us so that we can all live here. But that hierarchical relationship is not part of Gidina Windaman. It's not part of we're all related. It's not part of Gidakimanan, everything in creation. And so working as a systems changer in residence with CASC and supporting everyone, including the Indigenous folks that work, these are what a scholar I've quoted talks about as PWIs, predominantly white institutions. They were not created by and for Indigenous peoples. And so there's always going to be a coming together or a nexus within these institutions, like universities, governments. And so yesterday we talked about having a community of practice together. And I love the idea of a community of practice. And I'm part of several communities of practice. So I'm part of one on good governance right now. We're on San Jose, California next week, with all these world thinkers on the crisis of democracy that was happening and continues to happen predominantly in the US. And so I'm going down there and talking about our traditional ancestral ways of doing governance, but also good governance, not just from the perspective of nation states, but you know, how we govern ourselves as human beings. And so on a collective wisdom journey together, I think this is the entry point is asking different questions. Should we decolonize a PWI? Does a PWI have the mechanisms within it for spiritual integrity? Because if a PWI, like a university, or a museum or a science center or other organizations, if they don't have within them mechanisms for spiritual integrity, that's going to be really harmful for us, because the first thing we're going to want to see is spiritual integrity, right? A lot of us as Anishinaabe people, we're going to want to know that we're privileging Anishinaabe, Yik, and Dasawin, and that we're not just fitting into, as my Uncle Dan, he likes to use this analogy or metaphor of the cup of coffee, the add and stir model of reconciliation, just put a little bit of cream in there and stir it. It's still a cup of coffee. You know, you haven't really significantly shifted the power structures, the dynamics, the resource flows, what that really looks like. And one person on the board and one staff member who then takes mental health leave, because they're trying to do it all, and the emotional and spiritual labor of educating everybody about different things that they've lived through, that their parents have lived through, and their grandparents have lived through. I often say to organizations, you can ask me, because I signed up for that. And when I start whining, I whine to my Uncle Dan, and he says, never forget, Melanie, my niece, you come from a people who have the power to summon the very thunder beings from the sky with a pinch of tobacco. He says, just never forget that. And quit whining and go back out there. So all hands on deck, as he says, and thank you very much. It's an honor to be here and to be a part of your wisdom journey as you continue that process. It's ongoing. There's no really end point. I'll just let you know, like, spoiler alert, you're never going to get there. We're never going to be fully decolonized, but we're going to get to a place where we can say to our descendants, we set you up better so you don't have to suffer the way we did. Right. And you can leave some of that intergenerational trauma there. And instead, we're going to reactivate the best parts of what our ancestors fought for. I mean, they risked their lives. You know, they risked jail time for the ceremonies for me to be able to stand here and shake a rattle in front of you. So, thank you for listening.